Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. My name is Gorgon, the Wonder Cow. It's my pleasure to be here casting the JDL Asia Premier Series game here between Execration and Mineski. I'm joined, as often, hopefully as always in the future, by my regular ball and chain, Toffees DOTA. How you doing this morning, bud?
Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Good morning, everyone.
All right. And a man of few words, you can find Toffees over at Toffees underscore Dota 2. So, as we move in here, Execration and Mineski, give me the lowdown on some of these teams, Toffees.
So, right now, if you go over to Dota Lounge, you want to place a bet, the matchup is about 75 to 25 in favor of Mineski. So, Mineski, one of the top-ranked teams right now, up in that 22 to 30, depending on who you're talking to for ranks, known for their presence in the SEA scene. And on the other side of the coin, we have I always mess up how to say the name because it's not my typical spelling. It is Execration is sitting from that 87 to 115 rank. Now, when they joined JDL this season, they were above 100. So they were, I think, at 120. And since then, they've been able to gain some world ranks as far as a couple of the communities are concerned, which I think has gone well for them. So what we're really seeing here is it's a great chance for Execration to really take another step towards setting their name as a top-tier Filipino team matched up against Mineski.
Yeah, despite the fact that Execration is lower-ranked by most ranking systems, taking a look at our overall JDL standings, they are standing just a little bit higher than Mineski, which I believe is sitting right at the very bottom. You can see that on your guys' screen right now, the overall standings for the Asia JDL. And this would be a really, really good point in time for them to make sure that they stay in, at the very least, stay in the top tier Premier Division Asia for next season. Already we're starting to see a couple of areas where obviously Titan really getting ahead of the rest of the teams. Orange doing very well as well. Execration, Rex, Regum, Keon, and Mineski are all down in this area where if they do not start performing and performing soon, they're going to find themselves moving down to the Division 1-2 playoffs or maybe even being booted all the way to Division 2 for next season.
And that's not something you want to happen, especially for a team that has on-hand sponsors. So obviously with Gigabyte, Mineski needs to make sure that they secure their location to keep Gigabyte intact.
All right, so why don't we talk about some of the drafts and bans here. Both the Enchantress and the Chen getting banned out here by opposite teams. The Bristleback has also been banned out by Mineski, and of course the Nyx Assassin going down by Execration. What do you see so far in this draft? What piques your interest? I know you're not normally too much of a Southeast Asia guy. Anything seems a little fishy to you? Anything here that you really like?
I think that was a fish joke with Slark. However, I like that Invoker is international. I like that everywhere I go, I get to see him picked in one of the first two spots. Sand King, however, is the thing that always catches me off guard when I watch the SEA. Sand King seems like a very popular support here, and I honestly almost never see him played over in North America.
Yeah, Sand King, I feel like in the North America scene and Europe scene, you really don't see him very much unless you're going for a straight-up roaming into five-man style lineup. In SEA, you're right, you do see him a lot more, although I will say that for both SEA and Chinese Dota, that Sand King is not normally a first pick situation. So the fact that he came out right out of the gate interests me a little bit. The Sand King, not known to be the most versatile of heroes. He pretty much fits into one basic role. You throw him into that roaming support situation or in a very, very aggressive sort of tri lane, either in the defensive lane or the offensive lane. And you try to give him up a Blink Dagger, and once you do that, you try to wreck your opponent's team as hard as possible. So, to me, that Sand King might tell me that Mineski is planning to see Execration do something along the lines of a push strat, and they want to punish multiple unit summonables that might come out of somebody like the Nature's Prophet. But other than that, I really don't see why they would pick him up first.
I also am interested. That is a big respect ban, by the way, with that Chen banned out by Mineski. Fox, known for his Chen, his most successful and most played hero. So they took that away from Fox, and it looks like he'll be playing the Rubick instead today.
Yeah, Rubick also a very solid hero. A great hero against Invoker, because not only does Invoker pump out a ton of magic damage, but in addition, he's got such a nice swath of spells to pick from. You'll never go starving if you're a Rubick and your opponents have an Invoker on the field.
That is the truth. So, interested to see what their next ban out's here. If they have done their research, I'd look for them to ban out maybe an Alchemist or a Marana here, unless they're going to use one of those two themselves. Both heroes are very popular and used a lot by Ninja Boogie, especially that Marana.
Yeah, the Marana, I feel like even if Execration does pick up that Marana, Mineski should be planning on a hero who will have that role, whether or not it's the Marana or somebody else, somebody who adds into a significant gank factor. Execration likes this very aggressive style. The Slark is already on the board. And once again, the frequency that Slark is chosen and the Doombringer is not banned in Southeast Asia continues to astound me. In North America and Europe, we almost always see that Doombringer ban along with the Slark pick.
And the other thing that always surprises me is I don't see Timbersaw or Clockwork aggressively banned here in SEA.
Yeah, they just kind of let them slide through, and they get picked up pretty frequently, but they aren't considered important enough to just completely take out of the pool. And I would not at all be surprised to see a Timbersaw picked up by Mineski here, along with the Invoker and the Sand King. Timbersaw adds a fair amount of gank, pretty survivable, and throwing down that Chakram underneath the Sand King ultimate really allows... They are going to pick the Doombringer for the Slark. So letting that get through on Execration's part, maybe a little bit of a mistake here. Doom a very hard counter to that hero.
Yeah, a bit of a ball drop there. I'm not sure who our fifth player is on the side of Mineski. I'm trying to figure that one out. Do you know who that no-name list is right there?
I do not off the top of my head know who is missing, but I will go ahead and also throw my brain at it as we move through the draft here.
So they have six on their roster. Jesse Vosh plays with them, usually in an offlane context. And I was just curious because he is a Timbersaw Clockwork phenom. So I was curious to see if they were going to try to put one of those in his hands. But I don't see him on the actual Here Today list. So I was trying to figure out if that was him or not.
You know, they probably said it in the lobby chat while we were working through that long wait, because Kimo is playing from a laptop and was having trouble with connectivity before the game, but we do seem to have everything together. And I may have just missed the update in terms of who that player is. So,
all right. So Doom picked up hard counter. Batrider, who we don't get to see all that often anymore, picked up by Execration.
Yeah, Batrider actually becoming increasingly popular in SEA. I've seen him almost every single day that I've cast SEA this week. Three days ago, we saw a very nice Yamate Batrider that absolutely destroyed. And yesterday, we saw another Batrider. I forget who was playing it, but once again, absolutely destroyed. And Southeast Asia does not seem to be afraid of that loosened up lasso that doesn't reach quite as long. Shadow Demon, a very strong pick against the Batrider. A strong pick overall, and much more highly regarded in Southeast Asia than any other regional play in the world.
Also played a lot by Owa. Owa plays a heck of a lot of Shadow Demon and has a really good handle on that hero.
Shadow Demon is banned in the third pick every single game by Titan Gaming, which, of course, Titan being the absolute tip-top of the JDL Asia Premier right now. That Titan 4 slot is always picked up by... Literally, I've not seen them do a JDL draft without banning out that Shadow Demon in the third slot. Really highly prioritize that Shadow Demon in this section of the draft. And I guess the reason is because he's not quite good enough to be a first pick. Obviously not quite good enough to be a first ban, or at least not regarded enough for it. But apparently if you let him slide through, he will be picked up by your opponents.
Interesting. And that is a hero, once again, that over on the North American scene we don't see nearly as often played, but very, very strong. So many abilities that really play well with others. And obviously Disruption, just so good for setting up ganks.
Yeah, particularly this Burrow Strike Disruption combination with the Soul Catcher on top of it should mean some early kills for Mineski, assuming they do execute correctly. That Batrider, presumably going to be your mid. Naga Siren Rubick combo, also very deadly, but they usually, when you see that Rubick, is usually going to be a defensive Rubick with intention to kill rather than a Rubick who's actively moving forward into your opponent. He's more of a hero who punishes misplacement more so than moves in and tries to create it.
Now, do you think we're going to see that Naga Siren as a farming Naga or as a support Naga in this situation?
It's really difficult to tell. I think it's going to be a support Naga. That's my intuition. But in Southeast Asia, you do see a lot more of the farming Naga than, once again, you do in, say, North America or Europe. And our apologies to any of our viewers who are Southeast Asia fiends. I'm fairly new to the Southeast Asia scene. I started regularly casting Southeast Asia about 20 games ago or so. So fairly new. Toffees also in North America. Caster typically, so we're trying to get our feet in the water here and get our heads around the Southeast Asia drafting scene, but of course it takes a little bit of time and the scenes are just so different. It's strange how many different strategies pop up and how wildly different geographic differences make between these teams, considering they all can play together worldwide.
Very true, and I do find that interesting. Sometimes I'll switch up my servers on my queues just to see how others are playing, and it is a very interesting differential.
All right, well, Mineski looks like they're running very, very low on reserve time. They're down to 10 seconds to make their pick, presumably looking for a farming carry here. Nope, they are going to grab that Timbersaw. All right, so their Invoker probably mid, Timbersaw probably offlane, Doombringer likely going to be taking that farming carry role with the Shadow Demon Sand King doing some sort of a safe lane, tri lane, slash roaming support style. Seems to be the most likely configuration for Mineski.
Yeah, I agree with that completely. I'm trying to look at who is going to be playing what here. The Sand King's interesting because it's not on the list for Mineski as a commonly played hero by any of these players. So maybe it is something, this could be a very specific strategy that they've sort of worked out in a combination with that Shadow Demon.
All right, well, Execration, they still have a lot of flexibility in this draft. That Batrider can obviously go offlane or mid, and it looks like they are going to send that Tinker mid most likely. So this could be a farming Naga Siren. This actually confuses me a little bit.
Yeah, it does.
Farming Batrider, Tinker mid, Slark offlane with Rubick Naga Siren?
I think that's really the best setup you can do when you pick up that Tinker, because, yeah, I think that has to be it.
And we are going to see some disconnects, so we're going to go ahead and throw to the lobby screen as we get back in for this match, which is about to be remade. Apparently some more connectivity problems. So once again, thanks everyone for tuning in and working through these continuous connection problems that some of these players have been having. We appreciate your patience as we come through. My name is Gorgon the Wonder Cow. If you do like my cast, you can catch me at GotCowDota, and I'm joined by Toffees.
We'll see you shortly.
All right, welcome everyone back through that short pause. We appreciate your patience as these players do get in. We want to make sure everybody has the best connection possible moving in this game for the best action possible for both yours truly and our audience. So we're going to move over into the game here as all of our players and casters load. We should see this all pick. All of the players should be picking their heroes out pretty soon. And we are to the drafting right now, moving forward. So, Toffees, when I said that we probably expect an aggressive trialing coming out of Execration, you agreed. Do you think that that is going to move towards a push-style tinker or more toward a gank-style tinker?
Based on my experience, I want to say it's going to be a push-style tinker. Once again, don't spend a lot of my time in SEA, but I feel that it's less common to see that gank tinker nowadays as it is to see the push tinker, mostly because the gank tinker is great during that mid game, but not nearly as helpful as you move into the transition out of the mid game, whereas the push tinker start to finish is just a giant pain in the rear.
Yeah, the only reason I would expect one might go for, in this particular situation, go away from that Bulba style March of the Machines build, is if you really need a leg up in your lane, in that presumably mid lane, against your opponent. But against an Invoker, Tinker should be able to hold his own. I think that could really go either way, but I don't expect Tinker is going to need to get the laser and the rocket maxed out to force that Invoker out of lane and get his farm. So why don't we're going to have another pause, but we can go ahead and use this quick pause to run through our players. I'm going to go ahead and run through Execration here on the Dire side. We've got FY on the Batrider. Ninja Boogie zapping around to that Tinker. Fox is going to be zipping on that Rubik, and he's got a very, very nice set here as well. We have Naga Siren being played by Chemo, and you playing the Slark.
Down on the Radiant side, it is going to be Jesse Vosh playing the Timbersaw, as I expected. Jay will be playing the Invoker mid. G, question mark, will be playing Shadow Demon. Owa will be playing Sand King. And Jules will be playing the Doom. And I do want to say this. I watch a lot of Dota and see a lot of sponsored teams. And I've watched Mineski before. And the one thing I like about them is how prominent they put their sponsors up front. Which I think is something that a lot of teams could do to grow their visibility.
Not only are the sponsors up front, but all caps.
All caps.
Because you really want Gigabyte!
They're screaming from the Ancients. This is who we are. So looks like a pretty good matchup going to come out. And was when we talked a little bit about XCTM, we were talking about where are they going to put everyone. What do you think the chances are of they just run a Tinker on a hard Ancient farm?
I don't think that's super likely. I think they might rotate into that. Just like sometimes they will see a Tinker retreat from the mid lane and start moving into the jungle for neutral camps that the supports have set up if the lane is particularly difficult for the Tinker. I don't think they'll open up with Tinker on hard Ancients. Though if they did, I guess that would allow the Batrider in the mid, the Naga Siren to farm the... Well, yeah, the Naga Siren to farm the safe lane. They could put the Rubik Slark in the off lane. It just seems like a really awkward combination because they don't have... I guess they could put the Batrider in the off lane as well and put that Slark into the mid. But really, these are very abnormal laning, possible laning configurations. They could also go back to like a 2012-style Rubik mid if they really wanted to. It's just not very expectable. I would never put money down on Rubik mid when there's a Tinker Batrider out, you know?
Absolutely. No, I think he'd be in a lot of trouble, too, going up against that Invoker. So, not a whole lot right now. No items bought. Nothing for us to go over and analyze. Based on draft pick, do you have a favorite in this one?
You know, it really goes either way. This is so much a battle of execution. Mineski did grab that very, very nice counter to not only the Slark, but also to the Batrider and the Tinker with the Doom. That long silence is extremely effective against all three of those heroes. Mm-hmm. And they also have, I would say, superior team fight, but Execration really doing a very good job of securing that high octane style, we're going to be in your face and taking kills out of your mouths sort of lineup. And with the Rubik, the Slark, the Batrider, and the Tinker to throw down some split push, they should be able to knock down a fair number of towers after they start getting kills in the mid game. The one problem I see them having is actually physically doing the damage to those towers in early mid game.
Yeah. And, you know, going back to the talk about Tinker versus Farm versus Gank, I do forget sometimes these are two Filipino teams who I believe are rumored to be one of the more aggressive groups as far as Dota strategy is concerned. So I'm interested to see if maybe that Tinker does run in a gank position, because the gank configuration on extension, XCTN, is incredibly powerful.
I'm being asked over the stream for you to turn up your microphone a little bit. I don't know if you got my Skype message, but go ahead and turn it up just a little bit for the viewers. I'll also talk maybe just a little bit louder in case they're having a little bit of trouble hearing me as well. And hopefully as the pause ends here and we move off of this short break. Oh, never mind. We're not going to be moving off that break anytime in the near future, it looks like. But once we do move off the break, hopefully everything will be running smoothly, both on our end and on the player's end, for the optimal streaming conditions.
Absolutely. So I cranked up my mic as loud as I can make it on my side.
All right. Well, you are as loud as I can make you on my side, so I suppose that is about as loud as we can get you.
And if it's not good enough, guys, let us know, and I will just put my mouth closer to the pop filter. It's early in the morning, so it could just be that I am a quiet man in the morning and a loud man at night.
You have not had the opportunity to get that coffee in your veins, get all that caffeine, sugar pumping through you, and also you haven't had any Dota excitement yet. How could you possibly be too excitable if you haven't gotten your daily dose of Dota yet? Yeah, that's what we're here for.
They're going to regret us turning our mics up once the action starts.
All right.
Smokes bought up. It looked like Naga Siren picked some up as well as the Sand King. So we've got some potential ganks right out of the gate.
And I do like that Mineski has split up their wards, taking advantage of that mechanics change so that the Timbersaw is going to be able to throw up a defensive vision ward and still allow the Shadow Demon to throw up a rune ward here. All right, so as we're looking at these laning configurations, the Doombringer is going to be here in the safe lane as the farmer. He does have in tow the Sand King, and he has in tow the Shadow Demon. The Timbersaw is going off lane. The Invoker is going for the mid, so no surprises there. Well, it looks like we might see that Slark in an off-lane position. And will he have the supports rotate down to him or not? Tinker is going to take that mid lane. Or, excuse me, take that safe farm. That's something that we saw Yamate do the other day. It's not uncommon in this region of play. But not necessarily what I would expect with that Batrider available as well.
Yeah, and it looks like that's not a Rubick mid. That Rubick is just out there getting wards. The Batrider will be in the mid matchup against the Invoker. And I think that's the best usage of their manpower right now.
Timbersaw trying to come around here and creep drag. Kind of difficult to creep drag with the haste rune, as you can accidentally get yourself outside of the vision. And he's also trying to bait on Chemo, who might throw the net down right here. Decides not to. They're just trying to keep their creeps. That's really all they want here. Leave the creeps and get out, buddy.
So Timbersaw doing a nice creep jag. What was the benefit of that drag?
Well, if they are able to get the creeps from this lane all the way down to here, it will give Timbersaw easy experience for one lane. It will also give him easy last hits that he probably won't be getting for the duration of this 1-on-3. He can't really come out and be too confident getting very aggressive in terms of trying to grab those last hits. But if he can drag one all the way back to his tower, it sets the equilibrium back here rather than up here as the standard.
Which is much safer for him up against that tri-lane.
Right. So, also guarantees him a little bit of farm.
Yeah, definitely, which he's going to have a little bit of trouble getting. Obviously, as we know, Timbersaw, one of the most mobile off lanes, survivability very, very high, but difficult sometimes for him to get in and get those last hits up against these tri-lanes.
Yeah, the Batrider already has a bottle up, and presumably, yeah, is going to completely start trying to wreck with the sticky napalm. Batrider up against the Invoker, I would typically give the edge to the Batrider, especially if it's a Batrider player who has not taken the time off as many of the Western Batrider players have. That sticky napalm, the slow duration on your turn radius, as well as the stack damage, makes it extremely difficult to play against in a mid lane.
Yeah, makes sense. Yeah, he's already up at 6 stacks, so Jay having a heck of a time with that sticky napalm right now.
Yeah, 6 stacks, and if he does not back off of the lane, that's going to be up to 8. FY is literally just going to walk in with Firefly and have a very, very easy time of knocking that Invoker out of lane, possibly even killing him. Mm. Now, Invoker has gone for Quas Exhort, and because of that, he has the Tornado and the Cold Snap up, which will be extremely useful as defensive spells against this Batrider if he does try to Firefly in.
Yeah, definitely. And do you see a lot of Quas Wex building over here in SEA, or is Exhort still sort of popular?
I think Quas Wex has become a worldwide phenomenon. I've only seen one Exhort in any region of play anytime in the last 3 weeks. And that was yesterday with you in TECS. So.
And that was a amateur game. Oh, no,
right.
TECS, or was that?
Oh, like no, it was ADTL, excuse me. Yep. Amateur
so
game
that was an amateur game, so the pros seem to really favor this Quas Wex, and that probably last night was just an example of how the pros are forced to adapt faster than the amateur leagues are. Once Quas Wex became popular, the mids had no choice but to start learning it.
Yeah, I think one of the reasons that the Quas Wex is so much more in favor right now is because teams are already building a significant amount of push typically, so they don't necessarily need the Forge Spirits. But on top of that, teams globally are really prioritizing the ability to function as a team fight, mm-hmm. like to get these big ultimates like the Sand King, like the Chakram, and throwing that Tornado EMP in, that by itself is extremely valuable. We're also seeing a slight shift back towards slightly heavier farming carries, and Invoker with a focus on the Wex will have a higher attack speed, making him a more DPS-oriented hero, somewhat more along the lines of something like a Morphling, which is also becoming more popular.
Absolutely. I also think it plays into the fact that a lot of drafts have been less focused on picking up the disables, and the Quas Wex does allow Invoker to step into that role when necessary. So lots of fun so far in this Battle of the DCs.
Yeah, well, so far, it looks like Mineski is winning the Battle of DCs. May not be winning the game, but we are sitting at 0-0, 158. Have just about gone up. Why don't we take a look at some of our vision here? I'm going to switch over to Dire side vision only. And we see that the warding is prioritizing, A, giving the Batrider vision over the river. And you can see on the mini-map where I'm drawing here, so that he's able to get those sticky napalms up. He also has one rune ward up that's also going to be a defensive ward for these ancients, which are presumably going to be stacked at some point for either the Tinker or for the Slark, Rubik, Naga combination to try and go in and knock it down, presumably just for the Tinker. As far as the Radiant side vision goes, we've got this is a less common but safer cliff ward that it's more difficult to counter ward this because you have to actually drop the sentry all the way on the high ground and also fly the courier over or get vision through some mechanism. So it's less likely to be counter warded. It does provide that rune vision. Also provides a little bit of vision from the river up towards this passageway, but it does not provide east to west transfer on that passageway vision. So not the safest of wards in terms of vision, but much safer in terms of being counter warded.
And I think that at this stage of the game, that is fairly important. Is if you counter warding becoming very popular, especially on these early rune wards. So making sure that your ward stays up not only saves you significant gold, but keeps you safe because that is a massive cooldown on the second Observer ward purchase.
This Invoker, the Jay, has actually made a really impressive decision in my mind. As of late, I've been seeing a lot of Invokers open with the Blades of Attack go for that Wex style build. And the Blades of Attack, the extra attack damage, and the extra attack speed really help with last hitting. But this Invoker has decided to go for an early set on that magic stick. And doing that because he figured he'd beat up against that Batrider was a very intelligent situational build.
Absolutely. Up against that Napalm, he's going to be casting a lot of spells. Those charges are going to be going up very quickly. And he's going to need that extra benefit of mana slash health from the magic stick. So I think you're right. I think that is a very smart play.
Yeah, so Invoker doing a pretty solid job. However, Invoker probably won't run a bottle. If he does run a bottle, he won't have it up for quite some time. So FY will, I expect, be completely controlling the runes here. And especially if we do end up seeing this ward counter order, which I don't necessarily. The other thing about this particular ward, what it tells us about what this Timbersaw is planning on doing is that he does not really plan on moving beyond this line here. Otherwise, they probably would have put that ward here to give the defensive vision for any rotations coming across that gap. So without the ward that provides vision in this general area, It implies to me that that Timbersaw is not planning on being too ballsy up against this tri lane.
So, yeah, and I think that that's the right choice up against this tri lane, especially. They do have a lot of ability to keep him locked into position and slow down his escape. And I think that him staying where he is probably the right choice for his survivability and transition into that level 6.
Slark is moving down here towards both the Shadow Demon and the Sand King. He does have Pounce Up, which will help him get away if he needs to. However, both these heroes are level 2. Shadow Demon is yet to level something up on that level 2, though I expect that to be the Soul Catcher. The extra damage that is pumped out of Soul Catcher at early portions of the game, very, very valuable. But if he continues to move forward, we could see a first blood attempt coming out of Mineski.
He is just outside of vision range, correct, for Mineski, I believe.
Now, I'm not 100% sure how to pronounce it, so somebody in the stream maybe correct us if it's supposed to be Mineski, I believe, or Mineski. I believe it's supposed to be Mineski, though. To my Western eyes, it looks like Mineski is the way to go. Maybe a little accent on that E, but...
Yeah, hard to tell, but whatever it is, Mineski does have vision on the Slark, so they know that he's there. Slark will, I would assume, most likely turn and try to get out of this one.
And I do also want to point out that I had mentioned earlier that we'll probably see some stacking early on these Ancients, and that's part of the reason that this ward is here. Mm-hmm. Well, Slark is actually stacking right now.
Yeah.
So I hadn't noticed that when I said that, but worth pointing out that now that I've spent a solid 15 minutes staring at this pause screen, I finally picked up on the fact that he's stacking right at this moment. It's a smart move to have that Slark being the one doing the stacking, because Slark can catch up in terms of his ability to be active in the game so quickly. If he gets 5 minutes of free farm, he'll be able to get up the basic items he needs to be able to gank supports, and then he'll just move his way up the food chain. He's just so powerful and so difficult to get a hold of.
Yeah, and his ability to stack and not get himself in trouble, especially with rotations, that escapability is really nice, especially for Slark when farming the Ancients over on the Dire side. If he's farming them, all he has to do is pounce once, and any gank that's trying to get him is completely screwed.
All right, so we are still sitting here in a pause. Just want to let everyone, I notice that we are getting new viewers here as the pause continues, the great pause of 2014. Just want to remind everybody that we are sitting here in game number one. Nobody has won anything yet. You haven't missed anything on the score. This is Mineski versus Execration. Still, we've been having some connectivity issues with Jules, and before the game, Execration was having some connectivity issues with Chemo, but hopefully we'll be going here pretty soon. My name is Gorgon the Wonder Cow, and I'm here with Toffees. Toffees, if you want to, why don't you go ahead and plug however they're going to find you after the game, during the game, as you live tweet or Instagram the game. I'm not sure what all the kids are doing these days.
Absolutely. To find me, I do a lot of North American and South American amateur, semi-amateur scene. If you're interested in following and finding out about what's going on with the tournaments that me, myself, and Gorgon work, you can head over to Twitter and follow at @Toffees_Dota2, which I'll actually throw up on the chat. I'm sure it'll get buried ridiculously fast. But those are the Twitters. Feel free to follow. You get all the best information. And I swear we send out great stuff. So yeah. If you hate the cast, go there too. And let us know, because any follow helps.
or don't, if they hate the cast, don't tell them any follow helps. If you hate the cast, follow, and it's a way of telling us, you know, that you're aware of what we're doing, and you can go ahead and send us little passive-aggressive tweets. The other day, I forgot to lift up the overlay. I accidentally hit Control-Shift-2, or Control-Shift-F2, which was my old hotkeys, instead of Control-Shift-2, which are my hotkeys on this computer, and I got at least 100 tweets. Just cursing my name for the first,
really?
Yeah, for the first like 8 minutes of missing the overlay. So my apologies for that. Anybody who is still sore about that. But yeah, so if you do see something that you don't like, feel free to tweet at me. I will probably read it, though I might not. And if you do like the casting, feel free to drop by @GotCowDOTA, GOTCOWDOTA, and shoot me a follow.
But once again, that is the value of Twitter, is for those of you who have not cast before, it is very difficult because of the fact that the way that Dota is structured as a full screen game with side scrolling options, it makes it very hard to tab out a lot of times. And Twitter, we have it all activated on our phones and on our secondary devices so that we can see you and what you say to us in real time without a 2-minute delay. So it is the best way to communicate with your casters is to head over to Twitter and hit that follow button.
Absolutely. And, you know, We just like to be involved. It's great that Dota is such a tight-knit community and that people who are casting can still be involved and still be connected with people who are watching them. It's not to the point that it is in, say, traditional sports, where sports broadcasters don't really listen to or talk with, other than on a rare occasion, you know, the layman, the passerby. Whereas we are, in a day-to-day basis, being involved with our viewers and our fan bases and the people who aren't even aware that we exist, because everybody plays the game too. So we're all kind of thrown into the same ecosystem of Dota love.
Absolutely. Everyone plays the game. There's no, you don't have a lot of bystanders who don't know how the game works. So it does make casting a almost, I wouldn't want to say an easier job, but a more interesting job, because everyone does have an opinion.
Yeah, it certainly does make casting a more interesting job. I guess it's worth noting as well, since we are sitting here on this pause, Rubik is stacking here and he will be pulling. That's not surprising, but I hadn't mentioned it yet. We aren't seeing stack pulling coming out of down here, and it looks like the camp was actually blocked, though I don't know exactly what blocked it.
So it sounds like they're having the same problems on the SEA networks for Dota that we had last night when the patch came out.
The lovely patch tech problems that we continue to have. It always hits North America right in the middle of one of my casts, and now, joy of joys, I get to cast North America the night before with Toffees.
Yeah.
Stay up all night making sure that everything is just right for my Southeast Asia casts. Get up bright and early, bushy-tailed. For the same exact tech problems in Southeast Asia. I get it in every time zone. It's perfect.
Apparently, I should have just slept in and logged on at 8 o'clock for the cast.
Yeah, exactly. I could have just given you a call over here at 8 a.m. instead of at 5 a.m. Gotten you ready to go.
So, nice long. Everyone trying to get their connections worked out. And not a whole lot else to really go over. We have gone over the wards. We've gone over the stackings. We know what the strategy is going to be for both these teams for the most part. And now it's just an issue of getting these pauses and these connections in line so that we can watch them start to punch each other in the face.
And hopefully it will be a very aggressive game. It certainly has the makings of an aggressive game. This is an important match for both of these teams. If Mineski loses this match, they could very well be out of the running for JDL, not only for this season, but they might be out of the running for being certain that they'll be in the Premier season or the Premier League next season. So for Mineski, from this point forward, it is make or break time. And for Execration, this is their chance to get back into the middle of the ranks and possibly start to make the move all the way up toward being in the finals. They're not out of that yet, though they are getting to the point that if they lose a couple more, they will have a lot of trouble. I'm going to go ahead and throw up those Premier Division Asia standings for you guys since we are at a pause. We can see that Titan is sitting at 7-1. Orange is 4-0, so they haven't played as many games as Titan, but they are on par to be up there with them. Aero Gaming sitting at 4-2. Mythtrust sitting at 3-1, Scythe also sitting at 3-1, and those two are right now the two teams that are battling out for the bottom end of these finals brackets. In the mid round, all the teams between 4 and 7 slot in this division will retain their spot for next season, but won't go to the finals. That's Scythe, First Departure, and Spirit Gaming at the moment, but there are a lot of games still to be played. And then near the bottom, the 8-9 slot, which will have Division 1-2 playoffs with the top teams from Division 2 in order to earn their spot back in the Premier Division. That's Execration and Rex Regum Quion right now. And then, of course, Mineski taking up the rear of the pack and hoping to make a name for themselves here in the JDL, as they have across a series of other competitions in Southeast Asia.
And that is exactly it. And that's for those fans who are joining us that may, I don't know if we get a lot of North Americans. It is pretty early in the morning. But if you're not familiar with the formatting, that is a nice format. It's become very popular based on a lot of European sporting leagues. The idea that performance gets rewarded. So if you're coming in from a lower tier and you have performed well, you get a chance to play in the Premiership. Whereas if you can't keep up your performance for whatever reason, you get dropped out. And it could be lineups. It could be changes to patches. You never know what's going to be the catalyst that takes a top team from up there and moves them down to a lower tier.
Yeah, sometimes it's something as simple as work ethic, and sometimes it's something as extravagant as the play style that you're used to is no longer viable because of a change in a patch. And A lot of people accuse, like, say, Alliance of dropping off because 6.79 patch changed the playstyle and made their overall game strategies no longer as viable. I don't necessarily know that I buy into that line of dialogue, but it is something that we hear on the worldwide Dota stage. Oh my goodness, is this an unpause?
It looks like it could be. So this could be the chance that we've been waiting for to see some Dota.
I actually forget what Dota is, and at the moment, and that's going to be a missed tornado. At the moment, I'm still kind of staring off into space here, having a little bit of trouble getting my eyes to focus on the action. It's so colorful, Toffees. It's so colorful.
Things are moving?
What? What are these moving pictures you speak of?
I thought it was just a giant Dota poster in my office.
Yeah, well, you know what? The nice thing about that giant Dota poster is it is moving into a game now, and hopefully we'll continue without any additional pauses and have a lot of kills for you guys. Those of you who have been sticking with us in the Dota 2 ticket, by the way, on Dota TV, thanks for joining as well. I know we've been talking almost exclusively to the stream, but I'm hoping that you guys are going to get some really radical loot out of this game. And, you know, maybe Toffees or I will pick up an item as well. This is interesting. Timbersaw, once again, just kind of faffing about with creeps. He's going to go and pull over these neutrals, and Chemo's just going to let him. Absolutely no regard.
And Yu does get another successful stack up, so he's sitting at, I think it's two stacks right now over on those ancients. No, it might be three.
Yeah, it's three stacks. Three. It's a total of three stacks, but he is still sitting at level one. So he's been completely out of experience range for the bulk of this lane, and he can't really go in at this point because Shadow Demon's almost level three. I expect the Sand King, yeah, is well over level three. And hey, moving a level one Slark with just Pounce to get away into that combination is going to almost certainly mean a first blood.
Definitely. So he is headed back to make another stack. Interesting that he's not in there trying to soak any of that XP, and I feel like this could become very bad for him if he allows it to continue too much longer.
I assume that he's going to rotate over into the mid lane or the top lane at some point. I don't think they're going to be able to rotate into the mid against the Invoker, but possibly up here into the top and allow that Tinker to move out of there as soon as the Boots of Trav are up. So that's what we could see. Boots of Trav go up on Tinker, and he's going to, or maybe just before the Boots of Trav go up when he comes down. Oh, we are seeing Smash the top, and I accidentally clicked right away from it, but that's going to be our first blood as, wow. Long pause took away some of my ability to go ahead and do this. I saw the action happening and tried to click on in the mini map to make sure that we had it and completely zipped away from it. But yeah, first blood does go the way of Execration here.
So Execration gets that Timbersaw. We knew that it could happen. That top tri lane, very, very strong. And here's some rotations. So rotations and then smoke up on the top lane.
Yeah, and they are going to move in behind the Timbersaw. I was trying to bait something out. And it looks like Execration is not buying it at all. They do not want what he is selling. They know that they just killed him, and that something must be up. All right, there is going to be this stun coming out of the Sand King, followed by a disruption on a different target. Fox is going to go down to the auto-attack. Chemo now taking a couple of Shadow Poisons. He's also taking a little bit of auto-attack damage, but he should be able to get away, no problem. Timbersaw getting that last hit and getting himself back up. Batrider has come back to the mid lane now.
Yeah, Batrider's been doing a good job of stacking the creep camps in the forest right there. So if you look at that first creep camp, it is completely robust, and someone's going to be getting some good farm off of that very soon.
Not only is he doing that, but he's actually staying on top of the creep kills over the Invoker. He's a little behind in level, but not a significant amount, and he'll be able to go back there. He'll stack the tar, and then he'll take out both these camps with a single Firefly, which is a brilliant move on his part. The Tinker presumably is going to come back here, and then the Slark will end up moving up into this top lane to catch up on his levels. I assume that's the strategy. This is a very intricate, like, clockwork piece.
Yeah.
This is like expert origami being folded before our eyes. We'll see if it comes together without any incorrect creases, though, because it is very difficult to execute complex strategies like this.
It is.
In the bottom lane, we see Jules taking one more auto attack, and he will go down to the rotation. And that helps a lot. Slark now up to level 5 just about. After this creep wave, he'll be level 5. With that Doombringer being left alone, they saw an opening and Rubick rotated down for it. Up in the mid lane, we do see the Cold Snap going on and FY taking a little bit of damage. And the auto attacks would have finished him off if the Slark Nagasire didn't rotate in with the net for Invoker. Invoker's just going to have to back away. Up in the top lane, looks like we're having some aggression as well as Timbersaw chases the Tinker in. It is all over the map. Now here in the mid lane, it looks like we might see a rotation back in towards this Invoker as the Rubick rotates all the way around the outside. Maybe, maybe not. Naga.
Rubick has been all over this map.
Naga's going to take an EMP to the face. She is taking a lot of damage. And there's a creep to tank. There's going to be the tornado. Invoker's going to dive all the way in, and he is going to get that kill.
So great play by that Invoker. Good combos and a good tower sense to use that creep to make sure that he gets in there and gets that Naga.
Yeah, that was excellent execution from that Invoker and a little bit of luck. The clockwork piece still looking fairly good for Execration, but oh, we're going to see a teleport in as the Tinker shows off his brand new boots of travel at 7 minutes. What a time.
Wow. So that Tinker working very, very quickly. And Slark in a bit deeper than I think he wants to be right now.
Yeah, he's thinking about trying to get away. There's going to be the disruption and one Shadow Poison. There is just going to be the pounce to get away. And there is, okay, that's the first level Soul Catcher. So, oh, in the mid lane, we are going to go see the Lasso. As Jay is pulled back, he's trying to be punished, or they're trying to punish him, rather. One more auto attack, that'll get that, but the stun comes out of the Sand King a little bit late. In the top lane, we see Timbersaw has dove up. He grabs the Rubik, and now has been chased back by the Tinker. The mid lane looks like it's dissipating, but Timbersaw will presumably be able to get away here. He's going to throw out the Chakram and get away, as down here, the Slark does just narrowly get away from this Shadow Demon as well. An extra ward does go up here on the high ground for the Ancients, but has been seen and pinged out by Mineski. Wow, action literally in every corner of this map that there are heroes. And it's not over. FY is going to move in here as the net goes down on Owa. Owa taking a little bit of auto attack damage. FY can't quite catch up, and he's just trying to run himself around. He's going to loop around as the cold snap goes on Nagasire. Now they're going to try to re-engage. Slark managing to get a kill on Shadow Demon, the other side of the board. Meanwhile, the tornado manages to hit Chemo. Chemo being chased down. It's a couple more auto attacks, and the Invoker is going to back out. As the Rubik comes around, throws a couple of auto attacks his way. There's going to be telekinesis and the sticky napalms being stacked up on. But he's going to be pushed the wrong way by the Batrider as the Chakram goes out to cover his retreat. All right.
Wow.
These teams have it out for each other. And we were hoping for a high-paced game here after that long pause. It looks like we're going to get it, Toffees.
It looks like we're getting it for sure. I'm going to have to basically try to off-watch your camera and ping you out for the fact that these ganks are rolling all over the map.
I can tell you, this is one game I'm glad to not be solo casting. The ability to miss stuff on the minimap when there are literally two kills going on simultaneously, let alone three kills going on simultaneously in back-and-forth conflicts, ridiculously easy to accidentally miss something. So,
Jesse Vosh getting free farm up on the top right now on that Timbersaw, the first farm that he's really been able to get his hands on without too much trouble.
Tinker teleports out in this bot lane and lets loose the rockets. That is the Dogs of War, and Owa is hoping that he's going to engage as he hides in the side shop. But Tinker really more interested in grabbing these Ancients instead. And Slark is not going to rotate to the top. Instead, he's going to steal most of the experience from these Ancients, so that's how they're going to catch him up. Not with gold, but with experience, because Slark doesn't really need too many items.
And you notice that Sentry Ward is down blocking the Ancient Camp. Slark, okay, so Slark made that early stacking, presumably to keep them from putting the Sentry Wards down a bit later. So it's actually good that Slark stacked as early as he did.
Yeah, so Rubik has managed to grab himself a tornado, and now Batrider jumping in, getting the last one in the mid lane. There's going to be the Firefly, and it is going to be over before the explosive lands.
Right
down in the bottom lane, we're going to see a huge dive as Tinker tries to defend the Nagasire and is going to go in and throw out the net. The Slark has fallen, but will he be able to make a reciprocal kill? The auto attacks are going out. Now the Batrider's back. He's got a Blink Dagger up now. And he does not have a lasso, but he does have the Firefly doing a little bit of damage with that. And as the net goes out on Owa, not long for these world, a couple of auto attacks and the cast goes out.
So basically, that mid-gank initiated after the Slark started to get initiated on the bottom. And what happened is we saw the TPs coming out to try and rescue that Slark by the Ancient Pit. And Batrider took that as his cue to make a go on the mid.
Yeah, that is a very, very good point. That showed extraordinarily strong real-time map awareness and game sense. If all of your opponents are going to be in one lane, that's the perfect time for you to initiate in another lane. It was excellent. And the fact that the Batrider knew that he wasn't going to be initiating for very long just kind of cinched the deal. Just get in there, get out, bring one of their heroes with you.
So it was a great play. The Doom put up on the Slark. Slark not able to do anything to get away. And they just kind of let a merry chase until the TPs came in.
All right. Invoker is going to go for that standard Wex build that we see in SEA so often. He has gotten his phase boots up. Take a look at some of her items. The Doom does already have a Midas up. The Boots of Travel went up at about 7 minutes on the Tinkers. The Blink Dagger was sub 10 minutes on the Batrider. So the farm going very well for Execration. They don't all have their boots upgraded, but pretty solid items on just about all of their heroes. The Slark is the only one kind of lagging behind, but that's because he was still level 1 at like 3 minutes. Not really getting any farm. As far as Mineski goes, what do you see going on there?
As Mineski goes, sorry, I was trying to type to Twitch. Wait, looks like another initiation potentially up on the top.
Yeah.
No, it's
not. No, down in the mid, though. Fox is being attacked out. He got caught up in the tornado. A couple of auto attacks and some shadow poison. One more auto attack. Well, oh! What a use of wand! He's going to get away with 8 health because of it. And now the reinitiation as Chemo Thoughts, the Siren Song, and Shadow Demon is done before he can even finish the cast animation for the disruption.
Wow, so he gets completely... what a great turnaround by that Naga Siren.
Yeah, that is the power of a Naga Siren. I don't care how much you nerf Riptide. As long as Siren Song does what it does, it is still a top-tier pick.
It really is. It gives defensive benefit as well as offensive benefit, and that is why I think she's one of the strongest, maybe underrated supports in the game.
We're going to see a Blink in here as FY tries to come in and grab somebody, but he's going to be immediately Cold Snap, Tornado, and some auto attacks come out. He grabs the last one, but he's way too low in health, and he is going to go down. However, a very, very nice Shadow, or Rubik throws out a very nice set of nukes here. I'm falling behind as Chemo takes some auto attacks. He is standing on top of the fire as well, coming in a little bit. Yeah, he's trying to get away from Jules, unable to do so.
So they end up with a 2-for-3 exchange. Big initiation by Batrider that did not pan out.
Yeah, that Batrider moved in and did not realize how much opposition he was going to be facing. And looking at our gold graph, we're only looking at about 1,000 gold difference between these teams at 13 minutes. We're only looking about 3,000 experience difference, both of those in favor of Execration. No towers down, and it's looking like this is going to continue to be a slugfest for quite some time, as neither of these teams has been able to secure a lead, and both these teams can go into the mid and late game with a fair amount of evenness.
Yeah, a big difference from what I normally see in my games, where it's 14 minutes and no debt. Other than consequential damage just from creeps, nobody's really put anything on either of the towers at this point.
Yeah.
It looks like they're just based on a good old-fashioned slugfest style of strategy here.
Batrider is going to jump in. He is going to lasso this one going out. The Fade Bolt going out as well with the nuke, and that is all she wrote for that Invoker. And up in the top lane, meanwhile, we are seeing Slark move on that Timbersaw. Timbersaw is going to go ahead and Timber Chain himself away as the Tinker comes in. We got a Blink Dagger now. He's going to throw the rocket, throw the laser, and throw an auto attack. Timbersaw being forced off this tower, and this is going to be our first tower push attempt. In the mid lane, we're going to see 3 block up here with Execration, and they're going to try to push 2 lanes simultaneously. And it looks like Execration is going to try to exchange the bottom tower for the mid tower, but Tinker has come down and does not want to allow that, dropping down a lot of March of the Machines.
Yeah, and we'll try to push them off. It's still taking a lot of damage on the tower, but... mid and top going to be under assault here.
Yeah, up in the top, we're seeing Slark try to get a little bit of free farm. I'm going to switch over to net worth where we see the Doombringer is on top. That's not surprising, considering he does have himself up a Midas. Tinker, number 2, and Tinker should be up there as well with his ability to farm globally and his ability to farm those stacked Ancients. The rest of it going about... Well, actually, the Batrider's way up ahead, and that's kind of surprising to me. Oh, we are going to see an initiation here as... Oh, Naga Siren throwing down the Siren Song, and it will be all she wrote for Sand King. A very nice reinitiation, trading 1-for-1 for that Tinker.
So, and I think that is a great trade to get that Tinker at this point.
Yeah, the Shadow Demon might not be long for this world either. He's going to be netted down, and Slark is going to finish him off. As the Flame Break comes out, pushing off that Invoker, Slark has already used his Shadow Dance, and he is trying to chase in, but he does have amp damage on him from the Soul Catcher. The Doombringer coming in here and will not be able to finish him as the Dark Pack takes off the Soul Catcher and also does significant damage to the Doombringer. Now Slark is beating up on the lassoed Invoker, who will also go down in a million pieces. Timbersaw running in, this one at a time Mambo Line of Death. Will he get away? Yeah, they're just going to leave him alone, as there are several up on the map now, and they aren't 100% sure where any of them are. A DD rune is going to be up for that Batrider, though, which is, once again, a little bit of trouble. That is a pretty significant lead going the way of Execration.
Yeah, that Mamba Line of Death was exactly that. And I wanted to say, XCTM was doing a great job of managing the margins there, keeping themselves at a health level that was doable, but not disengaging where a lot of teams would have. So other than Slark getting caught by a surprise Timbersaw Chakram, the team was able to really kind of execute the way that they wanted.
Ooh, Timbersaw catches! Boogie a little out of position there. Instead of blinking into the jungle, he just kind of walked down the path and was immediately nuked down.
So right now, Tinker having a bit of a hard go of it. Two kills very quickly.
Yeah. However, Tinker is still sending up fairly high in terms of the net worth. Not too unhappy with his position, but you're right. A Tinker really, to be a valuable player, he needs to keep himself from dying, even more so than most heroes. Oh, we're going to see the cold snap go out as the rotation comes from the split. Sand King is going to secure that kill on the Rubick, and now the Naga Siren taking two stacks of shadow points. She is going to split, but she does have Soul Catcher on her. The Timbersaw coming in as well. He's going to throw out the shock. A couple auto attacks are going to finish that up as the Timber Chain goes over her corpse. Slark went down somewhere else on the map. I didn't even catch it. Over here in the jungle, Doombringer walking up and getting a reciprocal kill for his earlier death. Ninja Boogie jumping right into the thick of things, and he'll go down as well. Ninja Boogie, yeah, now starting to have an extremely rough run of things. The Batrider almost caught up to him in net worth there.
So that four-way gets Mineski right back into the kill count. So the two of them almost dead even after that 4-for-9 exchange.
Not only does that get them right back into the kill count, but they have managed to grab the first tier one. As FY decides to go ahead and move in and grab Jules. Jules does have the mechanism up. He tries to heal himself up as he's running away from the fire. He drops a little fire of his own, trying to scare off this Batrider, who does not have another lasso, of course, but he does have Blink. Oh, he's going to be caught up by the Sand King, who's going to go move in. A Flame Break is going to move out, and a couple auto attacks, but it's not going to be enough as the Batrider does go down. Doombringer sitting on top of, before that, about 100 health.
Wow. So dead even on the kills. Dead even. Wow. Look at that. Look at that gold chart.
Woo! That is a roller coaster I wouldn't want to ride.
So that is dead even on gold, almost dead even on XP. And things are just going. Lots of aggression on both sides of the table.
Ninja Boogie just right back to his old tricks, making sure these lanes are pushed out. He needs to make sure he's not getting caught out anymore, though. Three in rapid succession are about all that you can sustain from a Tinker on your team. Otherwise, the farm that he's getting from those lanes, not going to his other heroes, and does end up going to his opponents if he feeds. We are seeing Naga Siren just use Siren Song on two heroes over here. She does have the Tinker coming in, and she's just going to stand, use Riptide, possibly trading off her life. She is going to be auto-attacked. One more attack will do it. Will it be enough? No! The stun comes out. The miss from the laser is what caused that. Invoker unable to get that last auto-attack, and they managed to get that kill. What a ballsy play from that Naga Siren as the Sand King is mopped up and the Shadow Demon walking into a lasso himself. Slark getting a double kill there, and now Doombringer walking in. He's learning dance moves from his teammates. This conga, it just keeps on moving as Timbersaw comes in trying to support him. Now you, maybe taking a little bit of lesson or two from the same studio, trying to get away. He uses wand, he uses his leash, or leap, pounce.
If Doom chases this, he could be in some serious trouble, though the rest of the team is just across the river.
And Batrider is going to try to get away as the Timbersaw secures that kill on the Slark. What action packed. This well makes up for that pause in the beginning of the game.
Absolutely. Lots of action. And I want to say I have been incredibly impressed with Execution's, I can never say it, I don't know why, XETN's ability to play the health margins. They're taking huge risks, but those huge risks.
Well, I've got to interrupt you because we've seen a cold snap going on in FY who tried to get himself in. He force staff himself in to a load of hurt.
Yeah, that force staff landed him inside of an EMP chakram.
Yeah, and Invoker is going for an Orchid of Malevolence. He will have that up fairly shortly, assuming he's able to farm for a brief moment without being completely desolated here. Execration just constantly applying the pressure. And Mineski constantly trying to re-engage on that pressure. It is a very interesting dynamic here. A lot of give and take as Owa
bottom
caught out. Yeah, by you. The Dark Pact is all but going to secure that kill along with that net. And
lots of kills here, but what I was saying a second ago is that I watched an interview with a pro player not too long ago. Great interview. I wish I could remember who it was. And somebody asked him, how do you become a pro? And he said the key is learning just how much your hero can take, learning just how to play that margins. And that is exactly what XCTN has been doing in this game.
Yeah, very, very excellent execution coming out of this team, both in terms of that and in terms of their overall teamwork. The only hero who's really having a little bit of trouble coordinating with the rest of the team is the Tinker. And Tinker is usually a little bit autonomous, so that's not entirely surprising. Looks like Mineski trying to group up and take this tower, but as we kind of said before, they really just don't have any serious mid-game DPS against tower armor.
Yeah. And it, like I said, it's been very slow on towers on both sides, so it's not overly stressful in that. It's not like they've been losing towers like crazy and have to try to keep themselves in the tower race.
Yeah, neither side has the ability to really knock down towers. Ninja Boogie has the ability to push up to towers. But in terms of the sheer ability to overcome that siege armor and actually get some gold out of these buildings, very minimal. We do see that during all the action, we have dropped a couple towers here for the Radiant side. And the Dire still only down there one, but only, it looks like, is this mid up? No, mid has gone down two. So all the tier ones down for the Radiant side. Only one tier one down for the Dire side. And take a look at the gold graph real quick, Choffees.
Say that again, sir.
Take a look at the gold graph up there. It was a 3,000 swing into favor of Mineski, and now a 3,000 swing back in favor of Execration in fewer than 5 minutes.
You know, if I went to the doctor and that showed up on my monitor, they'd be concerned. So
yeah.
I'm also concerned, but that is crazy how this back and forth. It's been a veritable Filipino tug of war on the map today.
Yeah, no, this is looking a lot like a 2001 stock market, and it's making me a little uncomfortable to look at. I'm going to have to bring it down. Bad memories from those times, my man.
Smoke on the bottom.
All right, we have, the smoke coming down, but there's nobody down here to smoke in on. Meanwhile, it looks like Mineski, wise to this, is going to come down and defend this bottom tower in mass. All five coming down here. I'm going to move my camera over onto those heroes as they move in. And the plate mail's up for the Doombringer. So he is going to be working toward that AC that will finally give them a little bit of negative armor on those towers and also the attack damage and sustain on those towers. Maybe they'll be able to knock something down. There is going to be the Blink Lasso, and Doombringer going to be dead before he can react. Fox also taking a lot of damage, but he's going to be healed up by the mechanism. Nagasiren trying to get in on something. Meanwhile, Slark is just banging away, doing solid damage to both Oa and the Invoker. Oa gets his ult off, but it's not hitting too much of anything. Rubik has gone down, and now the Timbersaw in deep against Four is going to try to get away. The laser goes out, followed by a couple auto attacks. He throws down the Chakram, trying to get out Chemo, but Chemo is going to survive it. Now this is a 4-2 siege, a 3-1 trade-off, and what was that?
It was a 3-1, and they forced Sand King to use his ulti defensively, which you don't see very often, but that's the only thing that kept Invoker and Sand King up in that fight.
Yeah, Sand King's defensive ulti here is really one of the saving graces of Mineski's team, because they know they're going to be engaged on a ton, and it really forces Execration to consider the fact that they're going to have to deal with that when they're choosing their engagements. And imagine how much damage Execration would be doing if they weren't picking their pitches, if they were just able to go in willy-nilly without fear of that Sand King ult. That would be even more action, and a lot of it would be at the expense of Mineski.
So XP still fairly close right now. That gold graph, huge, huge dive all the way down to that 4,000 mark.
All right, taking a look at some of our items. We still don't have upgraded boots for most of Mineski. The Orchid is up on the Invoker. Oh, we're here in the bottom lane. It looks like, nope, Tinker is going to get away as the entire squad here tries to roam in and grab him. But the Shiva's up on Doom, so he's not going for an AC. I was wrong. He's going for more teamfight AoE, teamfight damage, teamfight slow. So not interested whatsoever in the towers right now, it seems. They just want to absolutely bash Execration in until they give up. It seems to be kill them until they GG. It seems to be both of these team strategies right now.
Absolutely. Mineski now is setting himself up for a late game a little bit more. Two hand of Midas is up on that side. And an interesting choice, Slark Ange, right out of the gate.
I like the Sangha / Sange pickup on the Slark. It does a lot of the same work that Orb of Venom would do in terms of its maim. But the extra survivability that it gives and the ability to upgrade that into a Heaven's Halberd, very, very effective. So I know that is not terribly common, but I do like it. We are seeing Oa try to move in on something here, and they're going to find themselves in illusion, and that's going to be their entire victory. However, now the entire Execration squad, or excuse me, Mineski squad, does know what's going on because of that illusion.
And they are rotating to take advantage of it looks like. So in they come. They know that the conflict's going to be up at this top tower, and it is the showdown at the tier one that we are about to see.
All right, I'm getting in the chat over and over and over and over and over again that you're too quiet. You're completely maxed out on my end. Is there anything you can do to turn that up?
I've literally gone over anything. So in your Skype settings, you've got me turned up as high as possible.
I believe so, but I will. As soon as we see a little bit of action, we will move out of this. Ooh, yeah, we're going to see a lasso move. Ninja Boogie is sitting here taking the full brunt of that Sand King Ultimate. The laser goes out along with the robots here, and yeah, that's going to be all she wrote for Sand King. Meanwhile, Timbersaw is trying to do a little bit of damage. As Slark dives in, he's been doomed. He's not going to be able to get away, but the Rubik doing telekinesis, merrily dodging that that Timbersaw, but he will end up going down to auto attacks. Doombringer charging him with the Timbersaw. They want to get this Slark. Meanwhile, Batrider's also retreating. The Ninja Boogie has returned. The Firefly is up. A blink in behind the Doombringer. There's going to be the tornado to stop the Batrider. Batrider is going to force staff himself over the ledge. Doombringer is caught off a little bit as the Invoker here is getting away. And it looks like that's going to be the end of this aggression. No, maybe not. FY might be caught out by Jules here. He's going to blink away. And we maybe might see a brief pause for me to go in and check those Skype settings once again, just to make sure that everything is maxed out here.
Meanwhile, I will pull up my volume mix to take a look at that as well.
All right. So it does sound like you're peaking a little bit. I do believe I have you. I can turn you up a little bit here. So why don't you go ahead and talk a little bit now?
All right. Let's see if that's any better for them, and we'll see what we can go with.
I assume that that is going to be a little bit better for the stream. You sounded fine to me the whole time. Sounded fine to me in the test that we did before the game, but now we have you turned way up. In fact, it sounds like you're peaking a little bit, and you might be able to turn down just a hair on your preamp.
All right, we'll take a look at that. And it's right now a little harassment down in the bottom lane. No longer harassment.
There's the lasso. There's the Firefly. There's the net. And the laser secures the kill. And Nogzard actually grabbing that kill with, it looked like, an auto attack.
Mm-hmm. So what starts this harassment ends in death.
Yeah, as is so often the case.
And still looking at, quick look at all the towers, all the tier ones down over on Mineski's side, and only one tier one down on XCTN. So the tower race is starting to really evolve here.
All right, Invoker is coming through here in the mid lane. It looks like we might have another one of these big engagements. We're sitting at 28 minutes, over 20 kills per team. I just want to point out how action-packed this has been. We've had more kills so far in this game than we see in a lot of full-length games that go like to 50 minutes.
Yeah, I think a playoff game we watched last night finished at 11-8 or something like that.
Yeah, at like, what, 50 minutes, 55 minutes, something like that. It was ridiculous. There is going to be a Roshan attempt. This could be a big break in the way of Execration, who are still only sitting at about 1,000 XP and maybe about 4,000 gold in the lead. So despite all of their hard work and execution, they're barely taking the lead here. They might trade off the tower for this. Ninja Boogie is going to be traded off for this once again. No, maybe not. FY and you teleporting in and holding down Jules, beating him. There's going to be the siren song. Maybe a little bit mistimed. The Shivas is going to go out. And I do not know why that siren song was necessary. It seemed like a little bit of a miscommunication there between the team. That is unfortunate. That siren song does not come back right away, and we are going to see an immediate re-engagement as Yu dives in towards his Timbersaw, who is going to miss his Timber Chain, but get away without any errors anyway.
So lots of action. They're going to push down, maybe turn this into a tower push. How low did they get that Roche?
They did not get it very low at all.
So yeah, they just decided that they weren't going to be able to get it down before the tower dropped and responded in spades by coming up and getting a kill instead.
Here in the mid lane, we do see, yeah, Invoker and Rubik ran into each other. Neither of them wanted that fight. They both ran off the opposite direction. Slark came in looking like he was going to go and try to get that Invoker, but instead he's just going to come up behind the entire opposing team, it looks like.
And it looks like Twitch chat is going crazy with better, so maybe the Skype settings didn't go through last time we hit apply, but for whatever it is, we are back, and thank goodness for that.
All right, very happy. Actually, with this pause, I am going to go in and check that one more time, make sure it is absolutely tip-top maxed out, and because, once again, your normally very, very nice microphone sounds to be flattening out your voice there. Since we do have the pause, just turn down your preamp maybe another 5%.
All right.
All right, and we are waiting through another pause, but at least this one has been earned. Both these teams probably wiping sweat off their brow. What a brutal, slugfest. We do see the Ags has been up on the Tinker for some time, and I have not actually mentioned it. That is a recent ad, 6.80, 1,100 laser range, and 4 missiles. So That's usually the sort of item you'd expect somebody to pick up if they're well and in the lead. In this case, Ninja Boogie's going to pick it up despite the fact that they are barely holding the lead, and he's actually not up on top's net worth. Normally, you'd expect the Sheeper to come out first.
Yeah, absolutely. Doom, though, it is worth mentioning, doing a great job of beating Tinker in farm, which is hard to do to beat a Tinker.
Yeah, it's... Well, Tinker has been caught out a whole lot. In fact, I have not had the kill death up at all this game, but we've got a moment to breathe. Why don't we go and take a look at that? That's Slark, who started off so slow, 9-5-5. Very nice execution overall there.
Very good. And honestly, Doom isn't that far ahead of Tinker in terms of kill death. In fact, I would argue that he is behind to a certain extent because he's died 4 times.
Yeah, Doombringer is sitting on top of the net worth. But I would agree. He's not doing quite as well as maybe he would be hoping to. In terms of holding down this Timbersaw, especially, holding down this Batrider, holding down this Slark, who's really getting ahead of the game.
Well, Doom is actually having to rely pretty heavily on that Hand of Midas to keep that very slight advantage.
Yeah, and that is going to dissipate here pretty soon. The level advantage is gone. He is the same level as the Batrider, the same level as the Tinker. So even though he has the Hand of Midas giving him extra experience, he's not taking a lead in terms of overall levels. In fact, he's behind the Timbersaw, who does not have a Hand of Midas, though it has finished his Bloodstone some time ago.
So it looks like XCTN has declared that this is the halftime, as this must be the Super Bowl of JDL for the day. And we're just looking for someone willing to sing the national anthem. I don't know the Filipino national anthem, so I can't be doing that today.
Yeah, I also do not know the Filipino national anthem, but I'm sure that if I tried, I would screw it up, and everybody in the Twitch chat would scream racism, so I'm just going to go ahead and let it go. Though it looks like Porcelain Lily is volunteering, so, all right.
You know it's been a long game with a lot of pauses when the casters are getting in on the trash talk in the game.
Yeah, definitely. This game has had more action than most 50 or 60-minute games, and in addition to that, this game has had more time than most 50 or 60 minute games. So we're taking the foot off the gas for a moment. Give both myself and Toffees a quick moment to breathe. As we move forward, we actually see this tier 1 in the mid getting very close to dropping. The tier 1 in the top here for the Radiant also getting fairly close to dropping. The tier 2s, however, for the Radiant side, more or less untouched in every lane. So there's been essentially no tower aggression from either team for maybe 15 minutes.
Yeah, it's just been a lot more rotations and going head-to-head. So basically, anytime that they see the 5-stack appearing, the opponent's just responding and going 5-5, which I think is made for a fun match, but is not very objective-based.
All right, we do potentially see an unpause coming here. Everybody has reconnected. Even the other casters are starting to reconnect. Everybody has taken their naps, wiped the sweat off their brows, and gotten ready to move in for round number 2 of game number 1. And we do have a second game coming at you after this, is the crazy thing. We're still looking at game number 1 for everybody who has just recently joined the stream.
That is, and a lot of folks have joined in and said, what's the score so far? Well, the score is 0-0.
Oh, we do see Timbersaw moving up here toward the Batrider, who has lassoed up. In the rear, Slark is going to move on Oa. Oa trying to get away. The very nice dodge on that pounce. Meanwhile, on the top, we do see some action going on as the Slark is now trying to take down the Invoker. He throws down the Shadow Dance and is going to move back towards the Timbersaw. Some missiles going out, hitting everybody. Shiva's going for it as well. And the Doom up on the Slark. Timbersaw now trying to re-engage on the Slark. And it looks like the chase is over there with a 1-1 trade.
Yeah, I think that disengage was a necessity, especially after Doom put out, took Slark out of that fight.
Yeah, Slark really didn't want to be engaging in that. I'm a little surprised Mineski didn't push their luck on that one, but maybe for the best. If they had re-engaged into that and gotten themselves into a little bit of trouble, especially if that Batrider had gotten himself up a little bit more, a couple of stacks could have really turned that around.
Definitely. So far, no real clear, I want to say, winner emerging at this point. We're at a 4,000 gold advantage for XCTN.
Up here, we do see FY moving in on Mineski Oa. He is going to go and try to get off his ult, but he goes down in the fires, and we will see him back in the Fountain Ear trying to engage, and he's now going to back up into the Siren Song as Tinker loads up the robots, brings him in. There's the pounce on Doombringer. Doombringer does not have Doom up and no way to get away. The mechanism is down as well, and he's being auto-attacked down. Meanwhile, a separate fight between the Invoker and the Nogger. Nogger is going to go down in that fight. Doombringer is going to go down in this fight, and now Slark is going to try to move on to the Shadow Demon, but he goes down to the tower because he did not get rid of that Soul Catcher very quickly. Now up by the Secret Shop, we do see Invoker, who took down the Naga Siren, chasing after the Rubik. There's going to be Telekinesis up by the Rubik, up on the Timber Saw, but he is unable to stay as he tries to back out. Tinker is going to teleport in, throws down the rockets, and now he's moving on the Invoker, who is going to go down as the Batrider moves in. And now Batrider is going to re-engage onto the Timber Saw, pull him over the cliff with the fires, auto-attacks into the robots. And the laser goes out as well. Timber Chain misses, but Batrider has to back out. He does not have enough health. The auto attacks are not going to bring down the Timber Saw. He is stuck up on the high ground. He's going to try to teleport away as the Batrider blinks away with the Force Staff. Oh, wow. What a blind attempt at the stun from the Stand King, who does not want to let up the ghost, and he will finally let it go as the Batrider has escaped. Woo! Wow.
And at the end of the end, Doom disconnects in the middle of that chaos. So lots of nuttiness. And actually, I think that was going to be very, very bad for XCTN until Batrider happened to stumble on a Invis rune here as he made his escape. So he was trying to get away. He was at less than a quarter health, found the Invis rune, was able to loop back around, get some health, and re-engage.
It's so hard to keep track of what's going on in those engagements. That there was literally a point in time over here where there were three different heroes in three different one-on-one matches, just all standing by each other, fighting each other, nobody helping the other guy. It was like pride matches. Just bring in the cages and we'll be ready.
That was quite, and that has been the story of this game. Long ongoing fights, not necessarily focusing one hero. Uh-oh, down on the bottom, looks like Mineski might be in some trouble.
Yeah, we do see G taking some fire damage. The BKB is now up on the Batrider, and he throws it up to make sure that he is not disrupted. No disruption means a very sad Shadow Demon. He's sent back to the Fountain the hard way.
So team came in to try and help out, not getting there in time. And Batrider will just head out of town. So
Batrider's
nice
just
kill.
A little too slippery for them to be able to get their hands on at the moment.
Blink Dagger, Force Staff, Firefly, catching him is just so difficult.
Yeah, and now he's got a BKB on top of it. And also, his Boots of Trav have been up for quite some time. So he is reappearing globally. Tinker's reappearing globally. We might see a Roshan attempt as Brubik has just been camping here as though it's a grand opening of a very, very fancy store. He's just waiting outside Roshan's Aegis Emporium. And might be opening time.
I don't think we've been able to see them. They've gone in on the Rosh a few times. They haven't been able to do tons and tons of damage. And it is about that time. So Chemo pulls up his images, and it looks like we're go.
All right, they are going to move on that. And Invoker might be smelling something. He is invis. And nope, he's not moving out that way at all. He's actually going to run into the jungle, expecting maybe to find somebody. He doesn't know where everybody is, but he knows they're farming something. And there's the ping. Everybody's aware of it now, but Invoker's running the opposite direction.
And interestingly enough, not the whole team is engaged on this, so that Roche is still going down very slow. Nice Sunstrike, sending a little bit of a message that they know they're there, and they're going to have to pull out of the pit.
Send a warning shot across their bow. Oh, there is going to be the blink, but a very nice disruption is going to keep that Lasso from being particularly effective. The Shivas goes out from the Doom, who is netted down. Naga Siren trying to wait out the time on that. With the Siren Song, the re-engagement comes. The BKB is up on the Batrider. Batrider's trying to do a little bit of damage as the Timbersaw tries to get away. Now, Ew, trying to re-engage. He does have Dark Pact up. He also has the Pounce up. The Disruption goes out defensively on G. Timbersaw now has re-engaged. He's trying to get around the top end of this engagement as Ew is going to use his Lincolns to pop that stun. And now some nice body blocking on him will secure that kill as Invoker throws down some auto-attacks. Meanwhile, Tinker over here on the other side is going to grab that Timbersaw. Throw out a blink, some rockets. He's got the 1100 range on that laser. Will he try to grab something here? No, he won't. He's going to TP back to base to refill. Meanwhile, the Batrider has come up around behind, and he wants blood from this Shadow Demon. He's going to go over the high ground, trying to avoid the Invoker. He's just waiting up here. And he will just kind of sit up here defensively, bottle himself back up.
So another big, massive fight that really only resulted in about 4 deaths. So both teams on these engagements are sort of splitting off into like 2 mini fights, which I think worked early on, but it's starting to cause some problems now.
And we did see the Glyph Force off here. by Execration, but there is not going to be a tower push by Mineski to follow it, as everybody has teleported in and is ready to fight once again. Yeah. I would like to point out, what kind of game are you watching where you see a team engagement and you go, you know, that only ended with half the players on the field dying?
That is true.
Kind of a slow one.
Well, I think I mean more mean the fact that it's just been these swaps. It's like a 2-for-2 every time, or something similar to that. Instead of one team, you have to take a massive advantage.
Oh, Doom is going to come in here, but the Sheeper is up on the Tinker. Tinker doing a solid amount of damage here. He reloads that. Throws down another laser and another rocket. That's going to be all she wrote for Tinker. Sand King tried to save him but was unable to. And Tinker's just going to get himself away because he is out of mana. Otherwise, that Sand King might have been on the chopping block as well. Oh, we're going to see, however, Slark is going to come in and engage on the Shadow Demon. And this is starting to look like Execration getting away with this game.
Yeah, Slark hungry for some Shadow Demon. And, yep, they're going to start pushing this tower. That tower already very low. They should be able to take it without a problem.
One thing I will say about Shadow Demon as a support, very strong, scales very well in the late game because Soul Catcher is a percent-based skill. However, does not scale very well in the late game with survivability and will be very, very easy for the Slark to pick off from this point forward, as well as the Stinker.
So they are going to draw back out, maybe move up that top lane. But so far, Tower Race going strongly to XCTN. And gold starting to favor them. XP starting to favor them. And gear-wise as well. What does Mineski need to do to make sure that they keep control or take control of this game?
Not giving up this Roshan is step number one, but it looks like they are going to give it up. At this point in time, they need to make sure that they force Execration to engage on a favorable note. Take down a couple heroes, take down this Aegis, and not re-engage after that. They need to get a couple of those tower defense-style victories, especially with that Sand King's ultimate that does not have a super long cooldown. Just using that defensively and making sure you get a couple of kills off the tail end of it, trying to make sure that this Slark doesn't get away.
And looks like they're going to trade that Roche for a tier 1 top tower. A good trade, in my opinion, for XCTN.
Yeah, that... I mean, they were not going to... Mineski was not going to be able to contest that Roshan at that point anyway. They don't have a million boots of travel on their team, unlike Execration. So grabbing something rather than nothing, definitely better for them. But you're right, as a trade, that went in the favor of Execration.
Absolutely, especially at this point where they've got all the tier ones down. It wasn't a huge loss. Already it was low. It's been under assault for a very long time. So not too bad. Uh-oh, EU caught himself a Doom.
And Doom uses the level death to pop off the Lincolns. There is going to be the Shadow Dancer reinitiation with the Siren Song. They are ready. Tinker is loading down the robots, and Doombringer has been turned into a pig. And we'll see him again when pigs fly. He is going all the way back to the fountain. And, oh, boy. Vash trying to get away on the Timbersaw, jumping up the high ground, but Batrider says, no thanks. Come on back down to my castle. And drags him all the way down onto the Burning River. That was like watching Lake Erie.
XCTN doing great work, lots of coordinated engagement, and it's very, very smart. That Naga Siren Song doing a great job of locking out the Doom until they had the Sheep Stick ready so that he could not put Doom on Slark.
All right, so, yeah, and Doombringer also, he did get caught out there, and he did die there, but I want to point out what a solid move that was to use the level death to pop the Lincolns and get ready to drop the Doom on him. Mm-hmm. Such a nice awareness of his opponents. Strengths and weaknesses, knowing that that Doom would pretty much mean that Slark had to unengage or disengage, rather. Slark is getting a tower here, and I saw a bunch of items pop up. I thought, oh, it was a courier kill. So a courier was killed somewhere on the map, and I did not quite catch that. My apologies. Too much going on for me to be paying attention to those little rats with wings.
I believe it was Mineski's, and I think that he was by the secret shop, but I could not tell you that for sure. However, just another thing going against them at this point.
Yeah, no outer tier towers left. And the damage is now up for Execration. We're out of that mid-game portion where towers are a little too difficult. Rubick has gotten Chakra Magic, Chakra Magic. There is no Kobold in this match. Yeah, so Rubick has gotten Chakra, which is going to make the next team fight extremely confusing for me. And for all the players. Which one can I step in? Which one can't I step in? Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God.
And that is absolutely true. That's the downside of some of these steals that Rubick can do, is that it just sows a ton of chaos in those team fights.
And Tinker not wanting any business with this Doombringer in the moment. No, he does. He's going to blink in after refreshing. There's going to be a very nice lasso blink, four staff, and Doombringer not long for this world. He's been having a rough time of things lately. The Shadow Demon is going to throw up the defensive disruption on Sand King, but Sand King's going to go down nevertheless. The BKB is up on the Batrider, who is just trying to drop as much fire as possible. The auto attack's coming out of the Slark onto the Shadow Demon, and now a very nice pounce grabs at Invoker. And Invoker will go down as well. Sand King is trying to stun himself back there. Oh, wait, no, that was a stun coming out of, yeah, Rubik, who has stole the Sand King stun, stunning out the Timbersaw. Timbersaw does manage to get away, but he is the only survivor to tell the tale, and it looks like he's going to be telling the tale of when his team lost a 45-minute game.
There is no buybacks available on the Radiant side right now, so this should very easily be a tower, both barracks, and potentially another if they do this correctly.
Yeah, this is, yeah, they're already getting the mid lane pushed in. The top lane is actually being pushed out by Timbersaw, who's feeling pretty confident out there considering how many blink daggers, four staves, and teleport boots are on the table. And he is going to be chased out. Nope. A cancellation on that.
And they'll go straight to, that mid tower. They've got the back door down, and they've got the ability to tank it. So I don't see why they wouldn't just take this tower while everybody's down.
Yeah, there's really no reason not to. Although we do see in Southeast Asia, there is a little bit of an, an honor kill culture where they dive in and kill heroes instead of racks all the time. A rocket's going in. Well, rocket for you, rocket for everybody. Batrider has been doomed out. He will go down. Defensive disruption will go out on the Doombringer. And Tanking landing a pretty solid ult there. The Sark does go down, but the Aegis is popped. The Black Bar is up on the Batrider, who is going to lasso the Shadow Demon, who does not really have a chance in this world for living through any team fight ever again. Fox is taking a lot of damage as well. Some auto attacks. He's been silenced out. He's got about 300 health left. Batrider trying to get him off. Fox goes down. And Jesse Vash now taking some auto attacks. He's got nowhere to go. The Sunstrike is going to go out and try to get a little bit of damage out, but a very nice force staff is going to get that Naga Siren away. And Jay, once again, not long for this world. And Timbersaw, will he escape this time? No, he will not. He will be netted down. That is a five-man wipe, and followed by a GG.
So not surprising, gave a little extra action, a few more pieces of gear to those watching on Dota TV, and the game goes to XCTN.
Just taking a look at some of our final scores. Some of our final gold graph, and it actually just dissipated. But yeah, what a game coming out of these two. And we are going to be right back with game number two. If you are enjoying this series, please, A, stick around, jump in the Twitch chat, come say hello. But also make sure you go over to Twitter and follow both myself, Gorgon the Wonder Cow, and Toffees. You can find me at GotCowDota, and you can find Toffees over at Toffees_Dota2. Toffees, any final words on this game number one?
Nope, just glad to be here. A lot of action, a lot of craziness, but impressed to see XCTN, who was not favorited. They were 75% down in the listings on Dota Lounge, and a lot of rares could be going out if this next game goes the same way.
All right, thanks to everybody for tuning in. We will be right back with game number two. Stick around.